Are we going?
Yeah, go ahead.
Okay.
This is Alyx for Pacific Nature TV. We're here with Ian. He just gave a nice talk to us here at the DAW Gallery in Pomona. And we have some questions that we sprung on here at the last minute. And
that's right. This is just ambush journalism. This is how they got rid of Helen. What's her name? The White House correspondent. You know that she was kind of, pro-Palestinian, somebody ambushed journalists. She had a couple of white lines, said something wrong, off script. Got rid of it.
So, one thing I was hoping to ask you about was in your most recent book, Censorship Now, you talk about this thing called DIY. You talk about the DIY musician self-pathologizing, these kind of things. What is the meaning of DIY? I feel like nowadays there's a very different conception of what DIY or a DIY music community is as to when you were making music back in the 90s in DC.
Well, DIY, I guess it used to be, I don't know. So at some point it just became this kind of linked to kind of yuppie values, like, farm to table, and this kind of craft society that we live, or a pro craft. I don't know, artisanal thing, and I don't know exactly when that shift happened. I don't know when the term became kind of co-opted, as they say, but it's definitely a term like indie that is not that cool.
So you mentioned yuppies and artisanal stuff. What are some other kind of signifiers of DIY in our contemporary era right now? You have the press dropping the words DIY all the time.
Well, DIY and indie, I guess everybody has to be DIY. Everybody, it's just really compulsory for all people. Like, it's very difficult to, unless you're a megastar or the president, then you really have to do everything yourself, And so the term is a little meaningless, I think, maybe. But it's more of a class signifier, it's like a coded word that infers things that aren't necessarily, the independent label, most record labels at this point are independent. They're not the major labels. The major labels are like RCA, Columbia Capital, so anything that's, owned by,
Universal.
But now, most labels are indie labels, and most work is DIY work. But those terms still have some kind of meaning, but they mean, middle class or something,
So, in that sense, what you're kind of getting at is that there's been a gentrification of what DIY and DIY punk kind of means. It has more middle class values.
Exactly. I would say that the terms came out of punk, and with the gentrification of punk, which is described in the book Censorship Now, actually, it's like...
In large part by NPR.
Yeah, exactly. Well, the gentrification of punk is what we call, indie rock now, and it's kind of taking, just like the gentrification of the city, it's taking, something and, making it cool for, contentless or, cool, like fun for the suburban sensibility. That's, in a nutshell, I would say that's maybe what it is.
I'd say one thing I've noticed is that, especially around here in Southern California, emo and garage rock are really trendy right now. There's revivals, as they like to say in the media, and Burger Records and records and labels like Top Shelf and Run for Cover. Why are these two kind of seemingly disparate musical expressions of rock and roll so popular with the youth right now?
Well, I think a lot of it has to do with the medium, and whenever you think about music and what's popular, a lot of it has to do with the delivery system. And right now the delivery system is like, telephones, and things have to be very immediate, and also the age that we're living in is a lot about things are kind of ahistorical and things are very, you know, people are talking.
It's a bricolage.
Well, and people are talking a lot about their, like, people feel overwhelmed, I think, thinking about any context or historical context. So they talk a lot about their personal feelings, and maybe that's where the emo, what you're calling emo. But I don't really know. Emo is one of those terms that I don't really understand. Because I remember when it came around, and it was kind of a derogatory term, which was talking about this kind of, like, poetic, intense DC music. And it was kind of a derogatory term. At some point, it became real music.
Yeah, I think now it's very interesting. On the internet, and, you know, Facebook groups, you have people battling over what the word emo means. There is a thing out there called the emo wars, where people are battling over fake emo versus real emo.
Oh, really?
Depending, yeah.
So what is
real emo, as defined by certain people, is it has to be related to hardcore music. So it has to be heavy. It needs to be intense vocals. You know, it comes from the DC, original DC context. But now, all the emo revival bands that you see, you know, Vice and Pitchfork talking about, they sound more like indie rock bands than they do hardcore bands or post-hardcore bands. So the fake emo bands are the ones that have all the twinkly guitars that sound like American Football or like Braid. And so, and you have these micro-genre designations people have been making on the internet, and they legitimately argue over for hours.
Wow.
Yeah, it's deep.
Well, you know, you learn something new every day.
Yeah.
That's cool.
So, someone told me recently that the press cycle goes from Europe to New York, and the last people to know are people on the West Coast. What do you think about that?
Well, I mean, definitely in the old days, Jimi Hendrix and Kurt Cobain, and, you know, everybody went to England to get famous. And that was definitely my experience, you know, being in makeup, and the Ulysses groups that I had that went to England, and the press worked the band, and then the group was made more, you know, got some whatever notoriety. I mean, whatever notoriety we got, it was from that. But that's only for a particular audience, because there's another audience that doesn't really care what the British say. And that was when the British had their British music press, which is not, doesn't really exist anymore in the same way. It used to be very powerful. The British had three music newspapers that really were tastemakers, especially for Europeans, but also for middle-class Americans. And there was the NME, Melody Maker, and Sounds, and they would, you know, they really shaped the tastes of a lot of people, but I don't think they have that. They don't have that power. But I still think London's a media center, you know, they definitely probably, you know, there's probably something, I don't know.
So, turning to current politics in the U.S., a lot of musicians tend to be on the left side of the political spectrum, if you can really call it that far left anymore, being a Democrat, and a lot of them are feeling the burn, as they say.
Yeah.
How do you feel about the current election and the sort of characters that are now out on the stage, causing more of like a spectacle, really, than a, you know, traditional electoral cycle?
Well, I mean, it's pretty crazy to see, because it's it's pretty.
Because like a recent statistic is that for the millennial generation, people favor socialism or capitalism, which is what we, I guess, you'd not expect. Capitalism marches forward unless it actually is destroying itself.
Yeah, that's an interesting thing. I mean, that's an interesting thing that, you know, maybe I feel like I maybe had a slight hand in, you know, it's like the idea of like, or I'm not me, but like, as, you know, people like me kind of, you know, just complaining. And using terminology that used to be quite, anathema. You know, you didn't used to be able to say the word capitalism where people would roll their eyes. And now people are aware of capitalism as something other than just an intrinsic, natural way that things are. And they're aware that it's a constructed system. And that's a real change from, like, when I was young. So I would say that's a big deal, and once you recognize capitalism, then it's almost impossible not to protest against the inequity. So it makes sense to me that people like socialism. And as far as the presidential cycle, we're just watching the death throes of an empire in crisis. You know, that's what it is. It's like a lot of the foundations of American power, like white supremacy and manifest destiny, are kind of being, they've shown their limits, their limitations. And people are freaking out, and they're so that's what I think is happening.
Cool.
And also, but the other thing is a lot of what's, somebody like, the Republican candidate or the Republican frontrunner. I think that a lot of the people who might have been in the Tea Party, or these people are just poor and they're desperate, and I don't think that they're people are just desperate.
Yeah, that's an argument of hers, that people feel like if you're from the working class, you've been left behind by everybody.
Yeah, exactly.
And
yeah, I don't think it's fair to just characterize them all as KKK or something. It's not that simple. For a lot of those people, maybe they got kind of just, there's something perverse, a perverse thrill about loving this, or voting for somebody who's,
speaks their mind.
It says perverse, the unspeakable. It's like to them, that's a protest. And I understand.
Yeah, being drawn to danger is one of the things people love about rock and roll.
That's punk. That's what punk is. That's essentially, if you examine what punk was in the beginning, a lot of it is maybe it's having its mainstream manifestations. That's what I thought about George Bush. I was like, he's like the punk president. He's kind of like, says crazy shit. He's anti-intellectual.
Yeah, I keep telling people we made it through 8 years of George Bush, make it through 4 years of whoever's left in that.
Hillary Clinton.
Either way, we all lose in the punk rock community.
It's great to talk to, what's it called, Pacific Nature?
Pacific Nature Team.
The Pacific Nature is a calm nature.
Chill vibes.
Get set, get side, stay true.